This morning I'm going to talk about turning grief into gratitude, 10 skillful ways of actually turning grief into gratitude. So grief is normal, part of being a human being. We tend towards grief. So in my experience, I remember when I lost my father in 1987. Actually, I didn't feel grief at all. But it was 1990 when I was in India by myself. I woke up midnight and I cried. When I remembered my father. In Uganda, as a cultural tennis, males are not supposed to cry. It's seen as a sign of weakness. I don't know about in Sri Lanka. I don't know about in Australia. It's expected females in Uganda and in general in Africa to cry wherever there's grief. Those are the people who are responsible for crying. For us, our responsibility is to see. So when my father died, I didn't feel even actually tears coming. It was bad news. But I don't know why in the middle of night, I remember even where I was staying on the veranda, it was a hot day, and I was staying outside, and I started crying. Unfortunately, at that time, I didn't have any skills on how to deal with it. I just felt relieved after crying, but not for a long time. It just came spontaneously when I was in the middle of sleep. And then I woke up, and then the first thought was my father. But that was a gap between 1987 to 1990. So it was 3 years that just the memory came and it triggered the tears. So then since myself I've experienced grief and I've of course experienced loss. Lost my books. I went to Tibet and got all my like valuable things and went to Nepal, posted them in with what you call cargo, and this courier to take it to Africa, to Uganda, and nothing arrived. So I lost all my books and everything that I had intended to take to Uganda. So I've lost relatives, I've lost friends. So this is my direct experience, actually. So I will be sharing part of it from my direct experience. So grief is definitely dukkha. According to Buddha's teaching, grief is dukkha, suffering. Whenever we experience grief, there's some kind of disharmony and then suffering. So what's grief? What's the cause of grief? And the way to go out of grief, we are going to see today. Okay, what's the cause of grief? What's the cause?
Attachment.
Ah, yes. The cause of grief is definite attachment. Whether you want to hear it today or not, that's the truth. The Buddha mentioned in the Dhammapada that from endearment, from passion, from attachment, from passion arises grief, arises sorrow, arises fear. And where there is no attachment, there's no grief. There's no fear. So how to overcome it then is non-attachment, isn't it? How to overcome grief is don't get attached. We have seen what's grief. Grief is dukkha, cause of grief is attachment. And how to overcome grief is not non-attachment. And then how to do it is actually for the Noble Eightfold Path, right understanding, right thought, right speech, right action, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. That's the way to overcome grief. In case you have grief in your life, this is the way, this is the path. And that could end the talk now. You don't need much. You know what's grief. You know the cause of grief. You know how to overcome grief. And the way is very clear. And the Buddha did this, explained this 2,600 years. But still we try to find out, how can I overcome grief? We know, but why don't we do it? Right, I'll spend my talk trying to explain things, but I think this is the path. It's very clear. So now, let us start with actually human nature. Human nature, in fact, we are called human being. The Pali word is sattva, which means a being who is attached. We are attached to our body. We are attached to our feelings, perceptions, emotions, mental formation. In other words, grief is part of sankhara, which is mental formations. And then we are attached also to our awareness. So that's what we call the five aggregates of subject to clinging. So now, because we are clinging to everything we have in terms of, let us say have, in the quotes, in terms of the five aggregates, which is our material form, body, that means body, feelings, perceptions, mental formation, including all the emotions, and then consciousness, that means whenever there is any loss, there is always grief. Whenever there's any loss, whether loss of your finger, whatever you lose, because you attached to it, then you feel grief. One time I cut actually my finger, part of it was halfway like this, and I saw it there. I felt terrible actually. That's the most terrifying thing that has ever happened to me. Just part of it, I saw it over there. I cut it like this. So even now, when I remember like this, I feel some kind of tightness because I was very young, you know. So then when we lose our feelings, also we have grief. We lose even our perception. When we lose our ideas, we attach to our ideas. And if there's anybody who brings another idea, that means we are going to lose our idea. Then we start grief. Grief comes in. And the thing is that also we are attached to emotions. We are attached to our anger. We are attached to our grief. So, in a way, that's even terrible that we are attached even to very difficult emotions. We are attached to our awareness. Now, yesterday I was talking to a doctor who's a surgeon, Sri Lankan surgeon. He shared his experience. Because he's always working with the people or who have cancer and all these things. He said that most of the time when people realize they have cancer, they have what we call denial. No, why is it happening to me? It cannot happen to me. So one of the process of grief, the first thing when there's a grief is denial. Denial. We deny. Even if somebody say, okay, your friend died. No, it can't happen. Everybody is dying, but your friend cannot die. This happened one time in Brazil. In Brazil, there's a friend of mine. The mother was 80, and he was in a hospital. And then the doctor said, she has a few days to die. Then there were two sisters. One sister said, mother, you are ready to go. Another sister said, no, you are not ready. There was a big mess in the hospital whereby one sister said, no, how can you say that my mother is ready to go? And the other sister said, no, mother is 80 years, so he has done enough. Ati, ready to go. So this is a denial. We deny. We, even when we know that death is part of the first noble truth, and everybody will die, the Buddha died, and all people died, Jesus and Muhammad, all people, we are even seeing this happening. Moreover, even it's happening from moment to moment, you know, in their life. You know, we are dying from moment to moment. We are losing new cells. We are losing new cells. I mean, we are gaining new cells, and we are losing all of them. This is happening on a daily basis, but we still deny that it shouldn't happen to us. At least not today. So this is very common. And another thing that another nurse, again from Sri Lanka, shared with me, that actually, it's amazing how many people live with a cancer for almost 10 years, but the day they diagnose them that they have cancer, from that time they start, their life start going downwards. They start grieving about it. 10 years, normal life with cancer, but they don't know. But once they know, they start doing, giving them, or even all the treatment they give them, chemo and everything, downwards. So is ignorance bliss or not? You are not to answer that. So anyway, I think it's good to know. But I think if you have some few techniques how to deal with it, then I think we can work with it. Right? So we don't get grief and all this. I mean, we get grief, but we know how to deal with it. There is a psychiatrist, it's called Elizabeth Ross, who came up with a process of grieving, but it's not linear. She said that when you have grief in your life, a few things happen. One is denial, isolation, then you get angry about it. Why this person did this to me? So why is grief happening to me? You ask why and all these things, and you get angry about it. So then, according to that person, Elizabeth, she said that there is isolation. We tend to isolate ourselves from the situation. And then there's anger. After anger, there's depression. And then from depression, she talked about also bargaining, trying to bargain. There's a few bargains we usually make in life. One of them is, if only I behaved better, before I separated, I would have been a very good person, you know, before separation happened. So we start trying to bargain. So this is the process. Another one is, of course, depression. You feel too sad, you give up, and finally you come to terms with the grief. That's called acceptance. So there's some dynamic sense in this process of denial, isolation, anger, depression, and acceptance. So I think this is very interesting that in Western psychology, they recognize actually the importance of acceptance, of grief. And I would like to talk also that any change, all right? Change, whenever there's change and there's loss, then definitely, grief is going to arise. It doesn't matter which change. Any change in circumstances, it might be change of place, right? It might be change in a relationship. It might be a change in diet. It can be change in anything. And if any time there's a change, we feel a sense of loss. And grief, of course, will come as an emotion. This is a strong emotion. This is more of a reaction to loss. And anytime there's a reaction, then this is happening. So the key is we want to start responding. Instead of reacting, we start responding to the situation. I think that's one of the things we are going to navigate around responding. But before we actually talk about how to respond to grief, there are certain myths around grief. One of the big myths around grief that I found out is that it depends on their culture. In Africa, they say if you cry, that that means you actually showing that you care about other people. But Actually, it's not about only crying that we grieve. There's so many other ways of dealing with grief. Of course, crying is okay, right? Some people say, oh, you know, I don't want to cry. And they say, oh, why am I crying? My answer as I give them is because you have tear glands. What do you expect when you have tear glands? Some people think they shouldn't cry. Other people, they think they should cry. So there's a lot of myth around whether you should cry or you shouldn't cry. What do you think? Actually, when you cry, there's emotional release. But we shouldn't use it as the only way to overcome grief. There's many other ways. It's not only one way. Another one is to ignore grief. Most people ignore grief and they say, I shouldn't grieve, you know. But actually the key is actually to face it. The best way to actually deal with grief is to face it squarely and see it as a process that it's going to unfold and then you're going to heal instead of ignoring, you know. So that's also a very common thing, to ignore it. Another one is, I think it's not maybe you, it's more in Africa where they think that males, they should, whenever they have grief, they should not cry. No, males should cry also, because we have tear glands, isn't it? So, this kind of thing that males shouldn't cry, I think it's a cultural trapping, it's a kind of a cultural burden that they put to males, that they should have no tears when they have tear glands, right? Another one is about the time period, the period when grief should last. Actually, there's no period. To some people, it can be one day. To some people, it can be 1 year. Other people, it can be 2 years. So there's no timetable for grief, you know? And allow yourself to grieve, because that's how to heal. And you go through the process, right? But you should know the process, and that's what we're going to talk about. So the process. So I just feel the fact is that to the degree and extent we are attached to something, it's the same to the degree and extent we can actually overcome grief. So if you are, let's say your attachment is 10%, right? That means also we are going to grieve 10%. If it's 50% grieve. If our attachment to an object is 100%, we are going to have 100% grief if we don't know how to deal with it. So, but if we know how to deal with it, of course, we can try to let go and then to reduce our attachment. Maybe if it's 10%, reduce it to 5. Because the nourishing root for grief is attachment. And you can only overcome attachment when at least you reach the third level of enlightenment. So before you reach the third level of enlightenment, grief is going to happen definitely. In one form or fashion, you're going to have grief. So this is very, very important to remember. So do you know Buddhist approach about loss and gain? Gain? Buddha said, this is according to the Buddha, loss of sila and wisdom, that's what you have to be very careful. Loss, it's called loss of sila. Sila is morality and wisdom. The Buddha said that when we lose morality and wisdom, that's the biggest loss. Because there is no single loss that is going to lead you to unwholesome states of mind or woeful states of mind like hell and all these things. You can lose your car, you can lose your friends, you can lose your house, you can lose anything, but nothing of that is going to lead you to hell or woeful states than the loss of wisdom and morality. Let's go to gain. this is loss, all right? If you lose, okay, this is loss, and then gain. So again, the same thing the Buddha said, gaining morality and gaining wisdom. There is nothing you can gain in this world, whether it's $1 million or whatever, that is higher than gaining wisdom and morality, because when you gain morality and wisdom, it's going to lead you to heaven. But gaining all these things, they just stop when you die. So in other words, all your gains are going to stop something, whether you gain a relationship, whether you gain something. So, but of course, we should have that understanding, at least from the Buddha's teaching, how the Buddha placed value to morality and wisdom. And then material things, yes, they have a place to play in our life. The Buddha is not downplaying the idea of having a house and a home and a temple. No, no, this is not what it is. It's just to see where you are going to place most of your hope, right? So we should have, of course, material things. The Buddha recommended us to have a minimum basic requirements, like we must have food, we must have shelter, we must have medicine, we must have clothes, but don't get attached. Just use them. Yeah? Use them properly. Alright, so now we go to how do we actually deal with the grief when it comes in our life? I talked about 10 ways. The first and foremost, I'm going to write them so that you can remember, is to be mindful. Be mindful, mindfulness of grief itself, of grief. In other words, when it's present, be aware of it, and when it's absent, right? When it's absent. Basically, this number one means face your grief, face it squarely. There's nothing that is going to help you to heal from grief than really facing it squarely. What's grief, right? This is very, very important. Instead, actually this goes against denial. Most people, when they have grief, they live under denial, right? That it's not happening. See, it's about recognizing, oh, this grief is happening. It's rising. Maybe some moments you won't have grief when you go for dinner with friends, and then you won't have grief that time. So recognize those areas, that time when there's no grief. That actually can strike a difference between getting caught in grief and also being free, because most of the time when we actually just sweep it under the rug and then we just don't become mindful of it, then it's actually roots keeping on growing, and then it will find its way out. You remember when I told you my incident, so my father died in 1987? And then I had no chance, for some reason, or I had no skills how to process it. It came up in 1990, and in the middle of the night, I wake up, and then I'm crying. You know? So this is very, very important to be mindful of it, so that you can process it. That's number one approach. And of course, mindfulness is going to spill over in all other methods I'm going to talk about. It's not only in the first method. Every method, mindfulness is very, very important. There is a story that comes down in the Buddhist literature. I don't know, most of you know it. Have you heard about the story about Patachara? Patachara lost in one day. A series of tragedies happened. I'm not going to mention them because you know the story. And he lost husband, lost two sons, lost parents, lost brother. How many people? Six in one day. Who has ever had that incident? None of us, maybe. Hope not. Now, he went berserk and then approached the Buddha. You know what the Buddha told him? Told her, be mindful. because she was naked. So really, I think she was so much overwhelmed. And then the Buddha gave instruction to be mindful. And then actually she practiced meditation and became even enlightened. She's one of the most respected female in the Buddha's dispensation for turning grief into gratitude, turning grief into understanding and all the thing. All right, the second method of dealing with the grief is, okay, how do we become mindful of grief before we go to the second one? So when you feel this grief, just make it the object of meditation. When you are meditating, usually your object of meditation is breathing, isn't it? So, and other emotions, maybe. So, when grief arises, grief, just mentally, not grief. They have made a scientific research that whenever there's an emotion like grief, and actually you mentally label it, it becomes better. This is actually scientific research that they have made. That is, they found out naming what you are going through, it can actually help it to reduce. Second is wise acceptance. Wise acceptance. Right? Wise acceptance means you stop running away from it, right? Don't push it away. Do not. Do not, do not, do not push it away, push it away. Do not indulge in it, no indulgence, no indulgence, indulgence, and not ignoring it, right? Not ignoring it, not ignoring it, but trying to accept, understand it, understand, accept it, right? Accept it as a fact of life, that grief is a fact of life. Most people might push it away, right? I don't want to be to go through this. Most people, and they will suppress it. Other people might want to indulge. Indulge in it, that means you want to show people that you are the only person in the entire world that is facing grief, right? So the best way, actually, also ignore. You don't want to ignore it. Because if you do this, any of these are what we call reactions, reaction. This is more of aversion, this is more of attachment to your grief, this is more of ignorance. You see, you don't want to have all these three states of mind. So the best way is to understand it, in other words, you are cultivating, you are becoming wiser, wisdom. This is very, very important to have that state of acceptance. And the Buddha said that, well, this is part of the first noble truth, that when you are born, being born is suffering, there's suffering, loss of loved one is suffering. So this is already we know, but actually when it comes to us, we don't accept it. We don't accept it. We are stubborn, in other words. Whenever there's something happening, we don't want to accept it. All right, so then we go to another one, which is also very helpful. This is more of wise acceptance has to do with attitude. Have a proper attitude. Proper attitude. Attitude. Alright? Attitude is very important. Okay, number three is investigation. 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 Body and mind. So when grief arises, because the body is biofeedback, sometimes we feel it in the body. Tears can come, you know, that's part of the body. So it's trying to investigate how you feel in the body. You feel tension? Do you feel tightness? Do you feel... there must be something you feel in the body when there's grief. Try to investigate. And if there's nothing you're feeling, don't create it. Just go to the mind. What does your mind feel when there's grief? Is there disappointment? Is there depression? Is there anger? So you have to investigate how it affects the body, right? How it affects the body. And also you have to investigate, is that grief increasing you know, from time to time, when you experience grief, sometimes it starts as a small thing and then keep on increasing. Sometimes it might be decreasing. So you have, this is part of your investigation. Is it decreasing? Is it increasing? Is it staying the same? Right? So you have to investigate that in this way. In other words, you are trying to get wiser when grief is arising. You are investigating according to anicca, dukkha, right? Dukkha and anatta, right? This investigation is very, very important for your understanding. Because when we do that, then we are with grief. Because now we are not pushing it away. We are seeing it. It's in the present moment. Then we are investigating whether it's increasing on daily basis. From moment to moment, we can actually be with the process. So in other words, here we are with the process, we are not with the content. Alright? This is process-based. Process and not content. Not content. So this one is not focused on the content of your grief. Okay, I lost my $1 million. So sidestep that and now stay with the process of grief as an emotion itself. You see? You see the difference between process and content? Content is your experience. But then process is actually how that grief is being processed in your mind. So you stay with the process, whether it's the process is increasing, the grief process, whether it's increasing, decreasing, or staying the same. So this is very, very important to gain wisdom under your belt. At least you get wisdom when there's grief. Most people, when they have grief, all what they gain is depression. They lose their peace of mind. But with investigation, at least you are getting wiser and wiser. So we go to the fourth. Depersonalization. Depersonalization. IMS. Not I, not mine, not myself. That's what you have to do. Because when people have grief, since grief is an emotion, so people identify their life with emotions, right? And when people have grief, they will identify themselves with grief. There's no doubt about it. When grief arises, people say, this is my grief. This grief is mine. In other words, they identify this grief is myself. So this is I. This is more conceit. This is what we call conceit, alright? You can conceited. And this mine. Mine is craving, alright? Mine is craving. And then S, self. Self, alright? This self is wrong view, right? So when you have grief, you don't want to have conceited that grief and I is one of the same thing. So I have grief. We can say it in a sentence, but actually grief and you is just not permanent. Like grief is just rising and passing away. So this kind of identification comes because you want to hold on to it, right? So it all works together, wrong view and craving for it and conceit. So the key is actually to just, you see this personalization? We take it so personally, right? So you need to depersonalize it. So depersonalization process is not I, not mine, not myself. See as grief as something that is arising, as an impersonal process. Grief is impersonal. It rises from one time to time, and also it changes from one time to time. So in other words, let us put this way, do not cling to the loss and all these things. Do not cling to the loss, to losses and all these things. Just see this as an impersonal process. Everybody loses, you know. And finally, we are going to lose our life, right? So I think human beings also are a little bit interesting in a way. Because when we are born with nothing, isn't it? We are not born with temples, we are not born with girlfriends, we are not born with cars, we are not born with robes. We come without robes. What makes us uptight when I lose my robe. Take a moment to reflect. At the time of birth, let us be very clear now. Are you born with your glasses? Are you born with your computer? Are you born with your temple? Are you born with a girlfriend? Are you born with your wife? Are you born with your daughter? Are you born with your son? Are you born with your $1 million? Nothing. I'm not saying these things are not valuable. They are valuable to us. But let us have some sanity when this is lost. If those things actually were very, very important, would you be born with all those things? Would you be born with our glasses? Would you be born with everything? Very hypothetical. In Egypt, the pharaohs, when they died, they buried with everything. They buried them with everything. Their clock, everything. I think that's also good, stretching it too far. The thought that once these people go to the next life, they have a good start. They have a kick start. They have a kick start. So I think this is stretching it too far, right? So, but of course, I'm not saying don't take care of your wife or girlfriend and all these things, even when you're not born with these things. But it means though that, okay, you take care when the loss comes, try to process it and face the facts of life, you know? Number five is called replacement. So we replace grief with gratitude. We are going to replace grief with gratitude. How do we do that? All right. I tell you what I do myself, and then you can use it in your life. When I lose an umbrella, that's what we have. We don't have so much things. When I lose an umbrella, for some reason, you know, it's very easy to lose an umbrella, you know. You leave it somewhere, and you go, it's raining, and then you come out, it's not raining. You can't forget. So I always say like this, whoever's going to find my umbrella, may you enjoy it. I'm very grateful that you have my umbrella, and then may you not get wet. So I turn attachment into generosity. Because generosity, what makes us disappointed is to see people enjoying your umbrella. That's actually what brings this kind of disappointment. You know? A sense of loss that somebody else is enjoying and I'm deprived. Actually, the sense of deprivation is what makes us very annoyed. Not the object itself. Not the object. It's the sense of deprivation that actually makes us disappointed. Now, when you use your wallet, this is, be real, okay? When you use your wallet, you look around like this, you don't see your wallet, this is what you do. May whoever gets in touch with the wallet enjoy, have a good meal, use all my credit cards, and may that person have some kind of sense of sanity to donate some to the Uganda Buddhist Center. not eat all, enjoy a good meal. May stamp over the website of Uganda Buddhist Center and donate a little bit. Try to plan for that person who's going to get your wallet to get some donation maybe to the BSV or something like this. But wish them enjoy. You see, this is what it does. This is what it does. When you substitute or replace one emotion with an emotion, it's very helpful. Because now you lost one wallet, which have money. and credit cards and all that. That's one wallet, physical wallet. And there's a big wallet you don't want to lose. You know the big wallet you don't want to lose is peace of mind. That's a big wallet. If actually you don't reflect like this, you're going to lose two wallets. One is a physical wallet, another one is a mental wallet, whereby always you're so worried and uptight and all these things. So for me, it's better to lose a physical wallet than losing this mental wallet, you know, because I need my peace of mind. I need my peace of mind. So then, what about the loss of a relative? Loss of. Whenever there is a loss in my family or my friend, I say that this person is upgrading existence. Upgrading existence. You know computers? They have Windows 10, Windows something. There's also Windows Vista. You know, Windows Vista was very painful. Somebody, you see, when I was in the United States, a computer wizard installed Windows Vista. Those who remember Windows Vista was very painful to use. I thought it was a new one and it's going to help me, but it became very painful to use. And guess what? There's another, it came after that, I don't even remember. Yeah, Windows 7. It was very, very good. So I'm telling you, if there's a loss in somebody, a friend, lose life, there is no need to worry. Say they have upgraded the existence from Windows Vista to Windows 7. So do you want them to continue using Windows Vista all the time when they could be better off with Windows 7? So in other words, this existence might have a lot of pain. So maybe when they go to the next existence because of their karma, they are going to be even better. And here you are grieving, crying and all these things. They are having a great time. You don't know. I better think that they are having a good time. It's like when somebody lived from Sri Lanka and go to New Zealand and get a good job. Do you grieve? If you have a friend who left Sri Lanka, they didn't have a job, because it's a very difficult job situation in Sri Lanka, is very difficult. They're having a job whereby they just very little money, they cannot even give their parents and all the things. And you know that they're doctors, they landed a job as a doctor in New Zealand, and they're getting a good salary, they're sending you some money, and they're sending money to Sri Lanka or Uganda or whatever. Do you start grieving that that person actually is enjoying New Zealand or Australia and all these things? Oh. Yesterday we visited a doctor, you know. The doctor is now in Ballarat, isn't he? Ballarat is having a great time. He came from England. And he made a good job. I mean, he has a very good job here. And the family is in a spacious home. Very beautiful. Is he going to grieve that he left London? No. So he's doing well. So people who live our life, they are doing well. Even if when you think they're not doing well, try to reflect, replace this thinking that they're doing well. Let us flip the coin. If your friend goes to a very difficult country, you know, where there's wars and all these things, so you don't feel happy. Because they're living a bad life. So now when somebody dies, you don't know whether they're actually leading a good life or a bad life. So why grieve? You haven't got that information that they are living a bad life. So better assume they're living a good life. And then you replace with great gratitude. I'm very grateful where you are that may you attain Nibbana. That's what we do in Buddhism. Wherever you are, that's why in Buddhist countries they bring dana and all these things, they offer generosity and gratitude, and then they transfer everything to somebody who passed away, wherever they are, may they enjoy. May they lead a happy life. We do it actually as a ritual. It's part of the way how to overcome our grief actually. This is a very, very important ritual. And to actually offer dana for the past one because it helps you to overcome grief. Right? What about loss of loved ones? Relationships, divorce. What about divorce? You split, separation. Separate from loved ones. Loved one. If I separate with somebody I love very much, do you know what I do? If it's my girlfriend, I say, may you enjoy wherever you go. If I say, may you not enjoy, then I say, always, okay, I want you to do it. But if I say, wherever you go, may you find somebody who's going to make your life happy. Right? And whenever you want to, just keep on going, you know. But if I hold on a touch like this, then I feel a lot of suffering. But if I let go, guess what? If I let go everything, I feel peaceful. Isn't it? So, then I lose friends, by the way. Okay, I don't have a girlfriend. In case you don't know that. But I keep on losing friends. I keep on losing monks who are friends. Good monks, I lose them. For very simple things. You know how I lose my friends? I tell you, you don't know the life of monks. You think that for us we are sheltered. You see, you don't know my life, but I tend to be very busy. I tend to be very, very busy. I have monks, friends who are very, very good monks around the world, German, but because I'm so busy with the first with my studies, with my practice, with the temple, and we are understaffed, and I have a teaching schedule which is very, very demanding. And these friends of mine, they don't have a teaching schedule like me. So they keep on sending messages. 2 days, no reply. 5 days, no reply. 10 days, no reply. Guess what? Bhante, you are ignoring my email. You are ignoring my communication, so goodbye. They check out. Yes, recently monk checked out. This monk bought his air ticket to come to Uganda. I had not enough money actually to lead a conference, the recent conference where we had ordination. He is the only monk out of all the monks that came that he told me that I'm going to ask my diocese to pay for the accommodation. Such a good friend like this, and I'm a spiritual director of his temple in Germany. I'm a spiritual director. I've gone to German team. I'm telling you, he sent emails after one. Of course, I sent gratitude for helping me out for the conference, but I was in the middle of my research and going to a library every day, then teaching, and Uganda Buddhist Center, there was something happening. So every time he sent messages, I don't reply them. One day he said, Venerable, thank you very much, but goodbye. Grief is going to kick you. So you know what I do? May you get on and enjoy. I don't hold on, okay, please, don't, please, I was so busy. No. What I found out, when we leave people to go, they will come by themselves. It happened. My cousin did the same thing, actually. He built a temple, and I wanted to take him to Japan, and there was no way how to organize his visa. He said, Bhante, if you want to know the life of monks, I'm telling you. So this person told me, please, Bhante, go your life, and I'll go my life. Separation comes. Do you know what happened? I didn't hold on to him, okay, please don't leave me. You build my temple and all the things, and you are my relative. I just accepted, okay, separation. After exactly 1 year, he wrote me an email which is quite the opposite. Venerable, I like you very much. Please give me a job. I don't have money to for my children to go to school. Please, can I have a job at the temple? Welcome to life. So that why I'm telling you this, don't try to cling on something when it's about to leave. When something is leaving, let it go peacefully. But the problem, we tend to cling on like this and we make it worse. Right? So replacement is very, very important. Replacement is very, very important. Number six. Of course, replacement with aversion, you replace it with metta, loving kindness, and all these things. Number six. Number six, reflection. Reflection. Do some kind of reflection. I think the best reflection that I found out is in is what is the effect of grief on your life. Try to reflect that. When I am grieving like this and going on grieving without any solution and I just get swamped in my grief, how does this affect my life? So we found out that grief, what it usually does, it actually defiles your mind. Every time you feel grief, there's a lot of defilement. It becomes strong and strong. So when you know that this grieving is bringing suffering, chances are that you start reducing those thoughts of grief, and then you let go about those thoughts. So reflection is very important. But the reflection that the Buddha gave is that from time to time you reflect like this. I'm in nature of aging, I'm in nature of sickness, I'm in nature of death, I haven't gone beyond aging, sickness and death. So, and also there's another reflection about separation, that everything that comes into union, it ends up in separation. Is that news? Everything that comes into union, come into existence due to union, right? Everything that beginning with union, it ends up with separation. That's the nature of life. So we reflect of the nature of life, this is very, very important. Reflecting also on love karma, that I'm the owner of my karma, born of my karma. I mean, I'm owner of my karma, heir to my karma, born of my karma, live related to my karma, live supported by my karma. Whatever I do, or good or bad, what I do, that will be my karma. So reflection is also very, very, very important, at least to come with, to turn the grief. And all these things, but what is very important, I think, more is actually to reflect what grief does to you in your life. Find its defilement, it also degrades your life. In fact, when grief turns into depression, actually it degrades your life. In other words, poor health. Reflection, poor health. Poor health, right? If you reflect along this line, then maybe you are going to reverse your grief, right? This is very, very important. Number seven, there are ten, right? There are ten. Number seven, redirection. Your mind, redirection your mind to P3. P3 people. Surround yourself with a lot of people. The more you have good friends around you, the more grief can subsides. Because when we have grief, we tend to isolate ourselves from people. So it makes sense if you do the opposite, grief will subside. But not all kinds of people. Find excellent friends, what we call noble friendship. Eh? Noble friendship, monks, nuns, good friends in your life. So don't isolate yourself. But also allow yourself, of course, space. Sometimes you want to allow enough space to grieve. Maybe go in nature. Place. Place. P stands for place. P stands for people. Place. Go to a place like nature. When you are in nature, nature is amazing. It brings happiness. Even they have made a scientific research about walking in nature. Actually, it has an effect on our mind. Go for walks in the nature. Right? Of course, another P stands play, exercise, right? Exercise, and be with the process also. Being with the process is very, very important. Stay mostly with it. Redirect mind instead of just being swamped in again, oh, this is me, you're getting caught up in a grief and all these things. Redirect means leave your mind, bring your mind to something else that doesn't cause grief, right? So in other words, when you are with people, go with people who are not experiencing grief. It is very helpful. And also people who have overcome grief in one way or the other. People who have experienced grief, but they have learned how to overcome it. But if you have grief, and then you visit another person who is caught up in grief, what will happen? You get more grief, is it? So suitable people is very important. I should put people who have overcome grief, like counselors, mentors, people who have walked the path. Go and associate with people who have walked the path. People who have walked the talk. Right? So this is very, very important. Redirection, of course. Then I think from time to time you want to redirect your mind to the breath, because take a deep breath. When you take a deep breath, you feel calm and peaceful. I think that's going to help. Another one, redirect to the body. You know, when there's a lot of grief in your life, come back to the body, feel the body. You know, most of the time when you grieve, we are so much into our head. Oh, my darling, when we had the honeymoon, we had this and that and that. You're always in your head, right? So come back to your body. Be in your body. That means you become aware of the body, sitting, touching, and all these things, and pressure, tightness, and all that. So the more you are in the body, the more you feel, I think, much better. All right, number 8. Okay, trace the cause, all right? Let us retrace. Where does grief come from, retracing? Where does grief come from? We said it already, craving. So knowing that actually why I'm grieving a lot is because of my craving and attachment, maybe memories, you attach to memories when you are with that person, how about to let go that memory? Because when we are, let's say we have our loved ones, you know, whenever the memory comes is when you are enjoying chocolate, kibat, and then something is connected, and you're still hugging on the memory. What about you let go that attachment? So when you retrace the cause, then at least you can deal with it. It's workable because it's all about letting go of the cause. So retracing, this is in Dhammapada. Go to Dhammapada number 212. This is called Dhammapada 212. The Buddha talked about why these things happen. Number 9, make a strong resolve in your life. Resolution. Make a strong resolve, grief not to be your master, not my master. In other words, don't be a servant to grief. Grief is not your master, right? So don't be a slave to grief. In other words, be stronger. Use every effort you have under your belt. You have a toolbox. You have so many techniques and tools to deal with grief. Use all of them to make sure that you overcome grief. But allow the time to process it. Lastly, number 10, I told you I'm going to give 10 ways, skillful ways. Is equanimity. Have you heard about Putasa Loka Dame Hichitaya Sanakampati Asoka Virajakema Eta Mangara Utama? Having a mind which is having equanimity is this is actually a great blessing. The Buddha said that it's soulless, it's not gluing on viraga, and it is asoka viraga kema. Is kema means secure. So in other words, the more you have equanimity, the more you are going to face grief. Equanimity, then somebody asks, how can I practice equanimity in when there's a loss? How do we do it? Reflection on your low karma can be very helpful. So I'm the owner of my karma. I'm the heir to my karma, born of my karma, live supported my karma, live related with my karma. Whatever good or bad I do, that will be my karma. So this is very, very helpful. Then another question is, what's karma then? That's another talk maybe. And next time I'm going to talk about equanimity actually. Next talk is going to be about equanimity. You're going to understand more what I'm talking about. But equanimity, let's say if somebody is having maybe some kind of disease, maybe cancer or whatever, maybe somebody has lost something in their life, and they come to you, they are grieving. What are you going to do? You help them, of course. You express compassion and all the things, but they are not overcoming grief. Or yourself, you are the one who is going through this. And then you did everything possible. All the nine techniques, you have done. But they are not working. So you have to have what you call equanimity. Equanimity, you can reflect along this line. If it's another person, I can care for you, but I cannot stop you from suffering. I can care for you, but I cannot stop you from suffering. That's what we call equanimity. I do care for you, but I cannot stop you from your loss. So in other words, you have what you call equanimity. Friends, this is 10 ways of turning grief into gratitude. What's the gratitude? Is actually from time to time, when there's no grief, when you're free from gratitude, from grief, then you actually feel gladness, you feel joy, you feel calm, you feel happiness, and then you start to live again. You start to live a normal life. Oh, then you say, I'm grateful to be alive. But when you have grief, you are not grateful to be alive. You join the club. You know when other people are suffering and all these things, and then you join them and you start suffering and you have grief and all that, you join the club. Dukkha Club, it's called Dukkha Club. Have you heard about that club? Actually, people ask me many times, Bhante. This is a question people ask me. Bhante, you have a temple in Uganda, but you are always teaching overseas. Who are the people who are going to teach the people in Uganda? Who are those people? Who is the teacher? Those days when I was asked this question, there was no... my mother was there as a nun. Actually, she's a good teacher. Not Dhamma talks, but her presence. People see her there and they say, oh wow, this is amazing. Every time there's death in a family, my mother give dana. And people say, wow, other people want to give, to take, but my mother want to give that. So then they're so impressed. And actually three people became Buddhist because of my mother. And I asked them, why are you becoming Buddhist? They told me, because of your mother. Your mother, whenever there's a death in your family, is the first one to bring food and donate to the funeral. You know, we do that in Africa because we live in a village. So actually, whenever there's a funeral, you have to contribute food and all these things. My mother, being a nun, that's the first thing she does. And then people wanted to join Buddhism, and I was in America. And then I said, okay, wait until I come back to give you the five precepts and three beliefs. When I came, I asked them exactly why they want to become Buddhist. They told me that. I was so surprised. So I knew that my mother's a teacher by precept and the actions. Now, people ask me, who's going to teach the people in Uganda? I tell them they have the best teacher. And the best teacher is called Mr. Dukkha. Mr. Dukkha is a very good teacher. Whether I'm in Uganda or not, my teachers continue teaching there. Because all people go through grief. All people go through all this suffering. And then, once they realize by themselves, then they'll need Bhante Buddharakkhita. They'll call me. So in other words, for me, I don't discriminate where I'm teaching Dhamma, because the Buddha, when the Buddha actually sent his disciples, he said, no, don't go in the same directions. Right? Go this direction, and spread Dhamma. So I go to every part of the world, spread Dhamma, and Uganda is just part of the world. So because Uganda also have a good teacher called Dukkha. So then I think I will end up my talk here, and I invite questions. If you have any question, okay. There are two questions here. Just a moment. She's the one who started. Yeah.
my grandchildren. My grandchildren were listening very carefully to your lecture, and it suits them very well because they lost their grandfather 2 weeks ago and came back from the funeral. They would know what morality is, using morality.
Okay, I'll talk about using morality.
Yes, and it's
morality is like five precepts.
They are very happy to have come today because that's the most suitable talk in their at this stage in their life. After coming back from this funeral of their grandfather.
Right. Okay, I'll explain what's morality.
Yes.
Ethics is sila. Yeah? Sila is five precepts. We have just taken them. If you lose these precepts, right? And then how you can lose these precepts is, okay, here's the loss of precepts. Where are they? You don't have them here. Okay. Panatipata vela manisika pada, undertake the training to refrain from taking that, you start killing. That's one thing. You start losing. And then abstain from stealing, you start stealing. Abstain from sexual misconduct, you start committing sexual misconduct. Abstaining from false speech, you start telling lies. You know, the ability to tell a lie, you know what it is? The ability to tell a lie, I'm going to tell you what it is. Okay, liability, you know liar? And then the ability to tell a lie is called a liability. Liability. This is a play on words. Liability, right? This the ability to tell a lie is a liability. How is it a liability? Fear, anger, stress, and all these things. So, in fact, when people, in the modern world, when people want to measure whether you are telling a lie or not, there's a machine that measures your stress as you're speaking. They use it with immigration. People coming from another country and other things, they don't tell them the truth. So, they just measure the stress. You suffer. Actually, when we talk about losing, going to hell, another word for hell is painful feelings. Painful feelings. Painful feelings. You go to Sanyutta Nikaya, another word for hell is painful feelings. So now, when you actually lose your morality, is losing any of those precepts. Right? Then, what about... you become liability in terms of fear, and all these things, this fear. Okay, another one is suramedaya. The losing that is you get drunk. You get really drunk, you know. We are talking about being drunk and still a street. You know? So, if you are keeping this, that's gaining. If you are losing it, if you don't keep the five precepts at the minimum, we're talking about the minimum, you are losing. So then the Buddha, according to the Buddha, he said that if you actually, let's say, this actually is very good. In case there's a loss, maybe a loss of relative, a loss of, is it not a good consolation that at least I'm not losing the 5%? Is it not a good consolation that at least I'm actually gaining my ethics? I'm gaining my wisdom through the practice of meditation and all the things? So that's what they have to go through that. Let them take 5% every day, and then at least they're gaining something, because that's the best gain. According to the Buddha, the best gain is gaining morality, ethical conduct, and gaining wisdom. Is it clear?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Another question. There's another one. Another person.
I just missed
the
third point. That's why I just
wanted
you to... I just missed the third point. You said was the mindfulness, second was acceptance. The third you said...
That's why it's very good to write like this. We just rewind like this. This is very good. That's why I like new technology. We just rewind. Even if I'm gone, we just keep on going like this. Investigation. Investigation is actually the Buddha talk about. I'm putting it in ordinary language because we understand some people might be new to this place and they don't know some of the technologies we use. Dhamma jargon. Anicca, dukkha, anatta. Most people don't understand this because on Sunday there are new people who come for the first time. That's why I use ordinary language, try to investigate. Of course, I'm not talking about becoming a private investigator. Right? I'm talking about when there's grief, try to investigate. How does grief feel in the body? Because the body is biofeedback. Whenever there's something the body is, the mind is feeling, the body feels also. So when you have grief, there's something that tightens in your body. You're not free. You feel that there's some kind of weight you have. So feel the stress in the body. How is that? How does it feel in the body? And also, how does grief feel in the mind? Right? Do you feel disappointed? Do you feel gross? Do you feel confused? You know, when you have grief, you feel confused, isn't it? You feel confused. What am I going to do? How am I going to live my life? So you investigate what's going on in your mind, if there's any confusion, if there's any other emotion that is coming up. Definitely anger will come up when there's grief. Try to see, in my mind I have anger. And then investigate, annoy it. And then the real investigation again continue with what we call investigating, what we call anicca. It's called anicca nopasana. Anicca nopasana. Have you heard about that? Anicca nopasana? Anicca, impermanence, anu, along with pasana means contemplation. So contemplation along with the changes. You remember I talked about how grief arises. It was, where was it? I talked about change. You remember I gave an equation where I talked about change. You see this change, then loss, and then the grief is a reaction. So how about when you step with the change, then you start to investigate it. That this is the change. You start investigating, the grief is changing, it's rising. Grief is decreasing. Grief is actually staying the same. Right? So this investigation will help you to actually deal with the grief. Then dukkha, of course, there's no need to talk about it. Grief is suffering. And then impersonal nature, anatta. You investigate, this grief is impersonal. It's rising due to causes and condition. What are the causes for grief to arise? Craving, attachment. You get to know that. And then why is grief in me always staying now? It's because I'm paying unwise attention to the theme of loss. You know, whenever you pay unwise attention to the theme of loss, the theme of irritation, definitely grief is going to arise. There's no doubt about it. What about when you start to pay wise attention? Right? You pay wise attention. You come to sanity. You send metta, loving kindness. You send gratitude to people who have taken your kude, your wallet. May they enjoy. Right. Okay.